Good morning, and welcome to Zion Presbyterian Church this absolutely beautiful, stunningly beautiful weekend in May. It's good to have everyone here visiting us today, and we also have the Reverend Dr. Gordon Matheson is with us today, and our minister emeritus, and we're always delighted when Gordon is here. And Gordon not only brought himself, but he also brought some good news that he and Azalea have been blessed with another great-grandchild, a beautiful baby girl this week, and the name of the baby girl is Azalea. So, oh, that's right. So isn't that wonderful? So God bless you, Gordon, and God bless the original Azalea, and God bless the sequel as well. There's more good news that I can pass on to you. The Presbytery of Prince Edward Island met this past Tuesday evening in North Tryon, and the presbytery approved the call that Zion has extended to Will Henbest, and Will has accepted that call. And so Will will be joining our staff as assistant minister this summer, and we couldn't be happier. Yes, indeed, that is good news. We couldn't be happier, and as I said to the presbytery, God is good, and God has a plan, and God's timing is perfect. So we're thrilled to have Will joining us. He'll be preaching for both Zion and for Calvin Presbyterian Church in Mermaid throughout the month of July, and he'll be inducted as our assistant minister in August. So that's great news. And that brings me to the fact that indeed the services at Calvin Presbyterian Church in Mermaid will begin again for our summer services, and that'll be at 8:30 in Mermaid. And then our summer services at Zion in June, July, and August are at 10 o'clock. And so for the next couple of Sundays, we're at 10:30. And then beginning in June, we switch to our 10 o'clock service time as well. So make sure to mark that on your calendar. And another thing to mark on your calendar is that our anniversary service is the last Sunday in May, May 29th. And that will be our celebration of the Lord's Supper as well. And everyone is most cordially invited to celebrate the Lord's Supper together with us on May the 29th. I think those are all the announcements. Diane is not here for me to ask this morning, but John, any more announcements from you? You sure? Good. I think we're all set then. And our worship begins with our keyboard ensemble, bringing our hearts into a place of worship with How Great Thou Art. Thank you. much, all three of you. That's a wonderful way for us to start our service together. Our call to worship is responsive. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. They are new every morning. And let's sing about the faithfulness of God with hymn number 482. Christ is made the sure foundation. We'll sing verses 1, 3, and 5. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. And together we bring our prayers of adoration and confession to God. Let us pray. Father, you are the one true God, whom to know is life eternal and whom to serve is joy and peace. And you've created all that is. And the whole universe testifies to the majesty and the power of you, its maker. We praise you, Father, for you have come to us in Jesus Christ, your Son, bringing salvation through a new covenant entered by faith. We praise you, Father, for you continue to come to us by the Holy Spirit, your presence in the world, and our comfort and source of faith. We praise you, Father, for you continue to speak to us through the Scriptures. The Old and New Testaments are witness to your mighty acts. And through them you reveal your holy love and lead us to Jesus Christ. You, O God, are the Father to whom we come, the Son through whom we come, the Spirit by whom we come. And so with the one church universal, we worship you, Almighty God, source of all life. With thanks we acknowledge your wisdom, power, faithfulness, and love. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, for as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be. As we enter your presence, Father, we are conscious of our unworthiness before you. We confess quite simply that we are sinners, for we do not care for the world as we should. We do not fulfill our calling to serve you through serving others. Our lives only dimly reflect the Creator's love. And our failure is sin, a rebellion against you, our God, an insistence that we be God in our own lives. We do not love you without reserve, nor our neighbors as ourselves. We place our hope not in you, O Lord, but in transitory things. We follow all too easily the ever-shifting values of our world. We make little effort to share the good news of your love with others in word or in deed. And so forgive us our sins, we pray. Hear our silent prayers of confession, O Lord. Hear the good news. While all people fall short of God's standards and need salvation, God's way to salvation has been revealed in Jesus Christ. Through the death and the resurrection of Christ, our sins are forgiven. And salvation means life, forgiveness, healing, and wholeness. It comes from God's grace received through faith in Christ alone. Thanks be to God. Amen. It's good to be in church today with our friends and our family of faith. And we have a very special guest who I'm going to introduce to you in just a few moments. And it reminds me of a story that I have about a flute. I don't know if you're very familiar with the flute, but there's a picture of the flute up here. And I remember the very first time I saw somebody playing the flute. And it was in high school. It was in grade 9. It was a little girl whose name I forget. That was a few years ago. But I watched her play, and then she placed it down and went to do something else. And I thought to myself, wow, that looks pretty interesting. I'll bet you I can make a beautiful sound out of that flute. So I picked the flute up, and I kind of looked at it and figured out which end to blow in. And I blew in it, and nothing. And so then I blew in it harder, nothing. And then I was a pretty strong guy, and I could really blow. I was a trumpet player, so I could blow pretty loud. And so I blew as hard as I could in this flute, and I didn't make any sound at all other than obviously I was doing something wrong. I tried blowing in the other end. That didn't do me any good at all. So I couldn't figure out what I was doing wrong. I tried pressing the various keys. Maybe that made the sound come out, but no. It turns out that to play the flute, it's not about how hard you can blow or about how big and strong you are. It's about knowing just what to do. Now, our special guest today, our musical guest, is Miriam Rhodes. And Miriam, would you be able to come forward with your beautiful flute? Let's welcome Miriam to our church today. Welcome, Miriam. It's good to have you here. Now, Miriam has exactly the same kind of flute that you see up there on the picture. Now, Miriam Schursel, tell us which end you blow in. You blow in that end there. You see, I would have thought you blow in this end. And there's something even more surprising. Miriam, which end does the sound come out of? Sound comes all over the place. And up there at the front, too. Like an aura. Oh, there you go. Very nice. You've done this before, haven't you, Mary? You've played the flute before. Now, I'm not going to ask to blow into your flute. Normally, in the old days, I would have said, let me try to blow into this and make a sound. But now, you know, we can't do that anymore. But I'm going to ask you to make a sound with that flute. You see, anybody could do it, except me. And you weren't blowing very loud, were you? Very hard. In fact, you probably couldn't even blow out a candle with the amount of blowing that you were doing there. But it made this beautiful sound in the flute. Now, you're not a very big person. Okay, I'm going to hold my breath for a moment, for we can be COVID safe. Small. Big. I can probably still blow harder than you can, and I'm bigger than you are, and I'm stronger than you are, and I'm older than you are, but other than that, you know just what to do to make that sound. Now, a lot of children think, well, I can't do anything that's really special. I can't do any great things for God because I'm small and other people are bigger and other people are stronger and other people are blowhards. What can I do? You don't have to be the biggest. You don't have to be the strongest. You just have to know just what to do. And God tells us just what to do. He says, you just need to love each other. Just treat each other with love, with friendliness, with kindness. And then you're going to make a huge difference no matter how big or small you are. That's what the flute reminds me of today. And that's what you're going to hear. And just stick around for a few more moments before you go off to Sunday school and hear Miriam Rhodes play a beautiful piece of music for us. And then think of how you can do something beautiful by loving each other. Thank you. Amen. Thank you very much, Miriam and Faye, together. And thank you, children. God bless you. You can make your way to Sunday school now. And for the rest of us, Sunday school, for those who are visiting, is upstairs in our beautiful youth room and youth Sunday school center. For the rest of us, let's continue in that spirit of peace and beauty and joy as we come to God with our prayers of thanksgiving and intercession. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for all you have given, for all you have done. We thank you that you've given us families in which we grow, friends with whom we celebrate, the needy with whom we share, a congregation with whom we worship. We thank you that you have given us purpose to live our lives and direction to guide us and inspiration to carry us through. We thank you that you have given us your word in which we find hope, your son through whom we find salvation, and your church through which we learn and serve. For all that you've given, Father, for this and for so much more, we give you thanks. In the midst of our thanksgiving, Father, we pray for faith. We pray for faith to make a difference in our families, for faith to share with our friends, for faith to help the needy. We pray for faith to live our lives and faith to see the way clearly, faith to overcome the obstacles in our path and the impediments in our lives. We pray for faith to read and understand your word, for faith to live according to the new life we have in Jesus Christ, for faith to serve your church and your world in ways that might make our lives really count for something worthwhile. We pray for faith, Father, even as we pray for those who have none, as well as for those whose faith is challenged by disappointment, by disaster, by disease, by death. Father, even as we pray for faith, we pray for hope, hope to persevere in times of doubt and struggle, hope in the midst of the endless conflicts in our world, hope in the face of a pandemic that seems destined to be always with us, hope for our country, our community, our families, and ourselves. We pray for hope, Father, even as we pray for those who have none, as well as those for whom hope is challenged by disappointment and disaster, disease, and death. And so this day we pray especially for those who are struggling with illness and their families, for those who are struggling with grief and for theirs. There are many names, Father. They are written on our hearts. We raise them to you now in this moment of silent prayer. Father, we thank you for all you have given, all you have done. Give us now and always a firm and unshakable faith and hope in you, and a love by which we share it with the world. Even as we pray together the words that you have taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our choir sings for us, God leads us along, and will be accompanied by Miriam Rose. Thank you. Amen. Thank you, choir, and thank you, Miriam and Faye. And through music and prayer, our hearts being prepared to hear the scriptures, we read from Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 through 18. And we ask the Holy Spirit to help us truly open our minds and ears and hearts to the word of God as it is read this morning. Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 through 18. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" Jesus asked. "Who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You're the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it." From there, we turn to the book of the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 19, verses 1 through 20. Just selected verses from that passage of Scripture, from this book, which we call Acts, which details what happens after Jesus ascended to heaven. Luke, the writer of the Gospel of Luke, records what is happening. He says, "While Apollos, another minister of the Gospel, while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul took the road through the interior and arrived at Ephesus. And Paul entered the synagogue and spoke boldly there for 3 months, arguing persuasively about the kingdom of God. But some of them became obstinate. They refused to believe and publicly maligned the way. So Paul left them. He took the disciples with him and had discussions daily in the lecture hall of Tyrannus. This went on for 2 years. So that all the Jews and Greeks who lived in the province of Asia heard the word of the Lord. In this way, the word of the Lord spread widely and grew in power." And finally, we turn to Paul's letter to that same church, the church of Ephesus, Ephesians chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. Paul introduces his letter this way: "Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, to God's holy people in Ephesus, the faithful in Christ Jesus, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ." Thanks be to God for the reading of his word. Let's give it an opportunity to settle in our hearts as we sing together hymn number 324, "Great is thy faithfulness." We will sing verses 1, 2, 3, and then we will sing the chorus together as well. "Great is thy faithfulness." Thanks be to God. Please be seated. What a great hymn that is. I could hear you just not being able to wait to sing that last verse, that beautiful chorus. I have to say, your singing was much better on that than on the first hymn. Christ has made the sure foundation, a big favorite of mine. And when I said to Faye, boy, I really want to sing that to open the service on Sunday, Faye said, well, they won't sing it. They don't know it. I said, well, it's a great hymn. I'm sure everybody knows it. Faye said, I don't think they know that all that well. And I said, well, play loud. And thank you, Faye, for doing it. You played so beautifully on that as well. I love that hymn. Montreal used to be very low on my list of favorite cities, I have to admit, but I have to say I've warmed up to it as a result of spending a few days there in Convocation Week. Not only do I have the happy memory of Convocation itself, held in the beautiful church of St. Andrew and St. Paul, but there are other memories and other places I want to revisit, like Ruben's Deli or St. Viateur Bagel. I can't wait to go back to there. But even more, boy, I'm hungry looking at that slide. Even more, I want to return to the churches. Whenever I'm in a different city, whenever I'm there with any city with Dana anywhere in the world, I love to visit the churches. And top on my list for Montreal is St. Joseph's Oratory, an incredible edifice, unmissable as it rises from the crest of Mount Royal itself. I spent some happy hours there looking at how faith can be expressed in stained glass and stone. I was even more eager to visit Marie-Reine du Monde, Mary Queen of the World, which is a one-quarter scale replica of St. Peter's in Rome. But don't think it's small. Even at one-quarter St. Peter's size, it's nevertheless the third largest church in Quebec. And let me tell you, there's some pretty big churches in Quebec. But what really struck me in church after church is that wherever I went, there was hardly anybody there. How long, I wonder, can these places possibly stay open? How long can they possibly last? My travels to many different countries and many different churches there has shown me that even the grandest church can crumble. I've seen a lot of churches. I've seen a lot of what used to be churches but aren't anymore. And I've seen a lot of places where churches used to be, but where there's just a few stones now marking the spot where the faithful used to gather. And as I consider the stories of these churches, I find myself thinking of what it was that caused some to vanish from history and enabled others to remain. And of course, I begin to think of our own churches and of their past and of their future. What lessons can we learn from these faraway communities of faith? What can we do to ensure that our church is there for our children and our grandchildren and theirs? This was brought home to me most clearly a couple of weeks ago when I received an annual report from a congregation I served from 1988 to 1992. Once thriving, it is now struggling to simply remain open. And closure is apparently the only way forward, and the annual report outlined a strong case for doing just that, closing the doors. Reflecting on churches now closed or turned into museums or repurposed into entertainment venues or converted into mosques or simply shuttered and left to ruin, it occurred to me that in each case the churches declined because they lost something. Some lost faith, some lost hope, some lost the battle. And we need to be certain that we don't lose those things too. We need to keep the faith. We need to kindle hope. We need to win the battle. We need to keep the faith. We need to keep our focus on the core of the faith, on those things which are of greatest value and importance, and not be distracted or led astray by the thousand and one things that clamor for our attention. We need to keep our attention on Jesus. This may sound simple, but the simplest things are often very difficult. If you don't believe me, think about a doctor's advice to eat less and exercise more. We would all look, I see some nods, I see a lot of nodding heads. We would all look like former Olympians if that advice was easy to follow, but it's not. Instead, many of us look a little bit too much like me. Keeping our attention on Jesus is surprisingly difficult. Churches spend an awful lot of time focused on the state of the building, on finances, on fundraising, on this program or that program, or this hot button issue or that hot button issue of the day, or on conflict arising between one group and another, and they lose sight of why they came into existence in the first place. We need to remember that we are here as a church to do three things. We're here to tell people about Jesus. We are here to help one another come to know and follow Jesus. And we are here to reach out with the good news of Jesus in word and deed to all of our world. Everything that we do as a church needs to be evaluated and reevaluated in the light of this basic mandate, bringing people into the faith, growing people up in the faith, and sending people out in faith. Now, a reading of the history of the early church will soon reveal how distractions arose, leading the energies of the church away from its central mission, often leading to conflict and fracture and fragmentation and decline. An overview of our own denomination's history reveals the same on a smaller but always damaging scale, because no less than the Presbyterian Church in Canada is facing steep declines in membership, deep challenges in keeping churches open, and increasing prospects of institutional collapse, while it seems that so often the bulk of the energy is being spent nationally on focusing on social, economic, and political issues in Canada and around the world, despite repeated heartfelt pleas to refocus our denominational energies towards the lives of the congregations which make up our church. We need to help our congregations and our denomination refocus on the basics. We all need to focus. We need to relearn the basics of our faith, to learn afresh and anew the story of our faith, to be reintroduced to the Word of God, in which is revealed the world-changing, life-changing, life-saving story of salvation. We need to experience the love of God made known in Jesus Christ, and we need to follow Jesus. We need, in other words, to continue on our mandate to know Jesus Christ and to make him known. We need and we must keep the faith. We also need to kindle hope. So often over the years, as I visited church after church, empty building after empty building, it became so clear that the people at some point had simply lost hope. They'd stopped trying. They had stopped believing that God would be with them, would be a part of their lives, would sustain their faith through their church. They stopped committing their resources to what they deemed to be a hopeless cause, and slowly their churches crumbled around them. They stopped envisioning a future of faith for their children. They stopped making the church a priority in their daily and weekly lives. And without necessarily making the conscious decision to do so, inch by inch, slowly but surely, they eased the door of the church shut and they walked away. They'd stopped trying. They'd lost hope. We must never lose hope. We must never lose hope because our hope is in God, who has been with us in the past, who is with us now, who will be with us tomorrow. We must never lose hope because to lose hope is to deny the presence and the power of God in our lives and in our world. To lose hope is to turn our back on the future, to grieve what was and what we believe never shall be again. Ultimately, to lose hope is to choose to live in the shadow, the dark shadow of the cross, forgetting forever the shining light of the resurrection morning. We serve a risen Lord. We serve a living Savior. And as long as there is a God in heaven, there is hope for us. There is hope for our churches. There is hope for our children. For with each new dawn comes again the promise that the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. They are new every morning. You know, it's Jesus himself who declared that he shall build his church upon the rock, and nothing, not even the gates of Hades itself, shall ever overcome it. The church has been here for you, is here for you, and will be here for you and for those who come after you, as long as we never lose hope, as long as we believe that the same power which raised Jesus Christ from the dead dwells within our hearts and within these walls and outside of these walls, as we bring that message of hope into our homes and our communities and our world. It is our task and our job to rely upon God to help us to kindle hope in our own hearts and in the hearts of all who are around us. Now, finally, many of the churches which lay in ruins or have been reworked into town halls or museums or theaters or performance venues have done so because they lost a battle. Or worse, they lost the war. For some, as evidenced in the sad little abandoned churches sprinkled throughout Prince Edward Island, it was a demographic shift as neighborhoods changed. For others, as in the rest of much of Canada, it was against the tide of secularism which swept the faithful from their pews. In other parts of the world, it was competing faiths such as Islam, which swept the East and very nearly the West. For many, the churches and the closures of those churches came as a surprise. People were unaware that they were involved in a struggle until it was lost. For others, it was a gradual acceptance of a new reality, a reality which no longer included their faith. Well, we may not realize it, but we too are in a battle. We are in a cold war of cultural assimilation in which the values of our materialistic secular society are threatening our very existence, and we hardly even notice that it's happening. If you don't believe me, count the cars in the Walmart parking lot on a Sunday. Or try to enroll your child or your grandchild or Gordon, your great-grandchildren, in a sports league that doesn't play on Sunday mornings. We couldn't find such a thing when Jacob was playing hockey. Or take a hard look at what passes for acceptable family entertainment on TV and wonder how things have changed. Or just consider this. It wasn't very long ago that you could have told me all the churches to which your neighbors go on a Sunday morning. They go to the Basilica, and those folks go to the First Baptist, and those folks go to the Christian Church, and those folks they go to Trinity. Oh, it's better than nothing. It's better. And these folks they go to St. Mark's, and you knew. Now you can tell me all the churches to which your neighbors used to go. This is nothing new. It's happened again and again. For instance, in Ephesus, the Apostle Paul himself began one of the earliest and most important Christian communities. In our scripture reading from Acts, we heard earlier about its founding, how the apostle worked tirelessly in Ephesus to establish a strong community of faith. For years, he worked there. And that community of faith was strong enough to be considered a threat to the economic order of the city. After Paul's years of ministry, the Apostle John ministered in Ephesus. No less than Jesus' mother Mary very likely spent some of her later years in Ephesus. Now, that's quite a team. The Apostle Paul, the Apostle John, Mary, the mother of Jesus. That's even better than the ministry team of Rolvaga and Henbest. Now, by 500 AD, one of the largest churches in all Christendom stood in Ephesus, and many other smaller churches besides. But sadly, that's just a model about the size of the piano. Because of the churches of Ephesus, all that remains now are a few scattered stones with crosses inscribed. They're gone. The churches in Ephesus are gone. But the 24,000 seat entertainment center, 2,000 years old and counting, this ancient theater still holds concerts. Pavarotti, Sting, Elton John has performed there. But of Saints Paul, John, and Mary, well, it's just a memory. The Church of Ephesus lost the battle. Long before the armies of Islam marched through, the Church of Ephesus lost the war. Well, we too are in a battle. It's not as obvious or as immediately tragic as battles we hear about in the horrible, senseless war in Ukraine. But in its subtle insidiousness, the battle that we are in is no less potentially devastating long term. Because we are battling within a culture which says, it doesn't matter what you believe or who you believe in, as long as you believe in yourself. We're in a culture that puts church on the lowest rung of priority, well below anything else that happens to come into conflict with it in terms of time or commitment or resources. We're in a culture where it's still fair game to undermine the integrity of the Christian faith, where novels like The Da Vinci Code and its many successors are runaway bestsellers, even as they defame the faith and scorn the memory of Jesus. And if we don't counter this unending onslaught with a determination to keep the faith and kindle our hope and commit ourselves to living as God would live, to putting our faith first, well, the day will soon come when the East Link Center and the Racino will still stand, but the churches will lay in ruins. We need to be aware that we're in a struggle, that we're in a battle, that we too need the same sense of determination and commitment and sense of self-sacrifice of any worthwhile soldier. No less than our faith and the faith that we pass on to our children and to theirs is at stake. We need to win this battle. We cannot give up. Now, the Christians of days gone by have a message for us. The churches of the past are preaching a sermon. The stones and the boards which once rang with song and now lie scattered on the ground are testimony to a great truth that we need to keep the faith, to kindle hope, to win the battle. We need to remember that we're part of the church built on the foundation of solid rock by none other than Jesus himself, a church that the very gates of Hades cannot overcome. You know, even in the mostly empty churches I visited in Montreal, the light of faith still burns, however dimly. Standing in the silence of a vast edifice, I would look around and there would be a person praying. There would be a candle lit. There would be flowers placed in celebration or thanksgiving, or now and again an organ would play, a foretaste of the Sunday worship to come. I pray that today those churches are filled as the faithful once again gather to keep the faith, to kindle the hope, to win the battle. We can do no better than to end with the words of the Apostle Paul, words to the earliest of churches, that of Thessalonica, where the faith still stands. Paul wrote, "So then, brothers and sisters, stand firm. Hold fast to the teachings that we passed on to you. And may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, encourage your hearts and strengthen you in every good deed and word." Fill our church, O Lord. Fill our churches, O Lord. Bring our world to you. Amen. And indeed, we bring our worship into the world with hymn number 490, God of Grace and God of Glory. Don't pretend you don't know it. Stand and sing together. So then, brothers and sisters, stand firm. Hold fast to the teachings that we have passed to you. And may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, encourage your hearts and strengthen you in every good deed and word. Amen. Please be seated. The choir will sing you out.